Praise God for worship, huh? Man, doesn't it feel good? I mean, if you let yourself just open up, you just really open up your mind and your heart when you're worshiping, it is amazing the connection that you can have. And I know some of you may not be ready for that, but I'm going to tell you, it is the most satisfying thing in the world. I'm not talking about worship today. I want to start with a story about, actually happened to me this week. My dad called me at work, and my dad's a little paranoid. But he said he was down at the house, and somebody opened the gate. You know, we live in a pasture. Most of you know that. We live in a pasture, right? And so somebody opened the gate while we were gone. Typically, I lock it in the mornings because he's paranoid. And we live on the same property. He lives beside us. And so he called me, and I said, well, I don't know who it was, Dad. He said, well, the weird thing was is that he said, I went to, get my gun. And he was really nervous. And so he goes, my dad's a Vietnam vet and everything. And so he goes to get the gun, and he goes to the back of the back, and he's going to get in the truck and actually drive up into the driveway. And he said, the gate was shut. He said, somebody had shut it. I think it was the wind. Don't tell him. And then he said, a little while later, he went up there and he made sure that it was shut and locked. He said, a little while later, he went back and it was open again. And, you know, my dad is just having a really hard time with this. And honestly, his paranoia was rubbing off on me. And so I've been kind of nervous the past few days about, is somebody kind of watching our house? And wondering if somebody's going to try and break in, or, you know, what's going on? We've been checking the doors and making sure that everything's locked. And last night I was a little nervous when we were sleeping. I heard something, and Griffin tends to like flip over in the bed and hit her head on the crib, and so it's probably just her. But I've been nervous and paranoid. Have you ever thought that somebody was going to break into your home? Have you ever had that feeling? Have you had a neighbor? Have you ever had it happen in your neighborhood? It's a strange feeling, isn't it? It's a very vulnerable feeling. When you're laying asleep at night, and I know some of you have alarms and some of you don't. Some of you keep old Betsy right beside the bed, and that works too. Have a dog, whatever, but you're nervous and you're afraid. What if I told you that, or what if somebody, what if not me, what if somebody just called and said, you know what, somebody's going to break into your house this week. I'm not going to tell you when they're going to break in, but they're going to break in and they're going to steal everything that you have. And here's the really, really bad part, is they're not just going to steal your stuff. They're going to come in and they're going to destroy your family. They're going to try and kill your spouse, and they're going to try and kill your kids. How would that feel? I don't know about you, but I'd be doing what I've been doing. Locking all my doors, locking the gates, checking left and right, and kind of keeping one eye open. You know, there is an enemy. There really is an enemy. That's what I want to talk to you about this morning. There's an enemy who's out to kill and seek and destroy your life. There's an enemy who desires to get inside your home, who desires to get inside your soul, who desires to come into your house and disrupt your marriage and disrupt you raising your children. There's an enemy who desires to break your witness. You know that witness that you have, that Jesus Christ has given you, that testimony? There's an enemy that desires to get into your head, especially if you're a believer. Now, if you're not a believer, he's probably going to leave you alone. But if you're a believer, there's an enemy who wants to come and destroy your life. And that's what we want to talk about over the course of the next 6 weeks. We're going to talk about lies of the enemy. Lies of the enemy is going to be the title of our sermon series. I really struggled when I was preparing this. I struggled in what I call spiritual attack. Now, some of you here may say, well, you know what? You're crazy, Justin. You're just nuts. No, I really believe that there's an enemy who is trying to prevent me from delivering this message. And so I want you to listen to this message. And if I fumble through it, I want you to skip over my fumbling. And I want you to pay attention to the content. And I want you to pay attention to God's word. And I want to start with a scripture from John chapter 8, verse 44. You hear the, there he goes. No. John chapter 8, verse 44. I want you to check that out. Now, these are the words of Jesus. How many of you trust Jesus? Do you trust Jesus? Okay, I just want to make sure because I think it's a valid resource. I think it's a valid resource. I was going to give him a citation, but he's in there, I promise. He's one of the main characters. And here's what he says. It says, he was a murderer from the beginning, not holding to the truth, for there's no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks his native language. Now, pay attention to that. His native language is lying. For he is what? He is a liar and the father of lies. That means that what Satan does, his job, is to lie to you. Maybe you woke up this morning. Some of you woke up and looked in the mirror. You couldn't handle the fact that you had big ears. Maybe you didn't feel confident about yourself. Maybe you looked and you said, you know what, I'm not of value. I don't like the way I look. I'm getting old. I've got wrinkles. Maybe you looked in and said, you know what, my spouse doesn't love me anymore. No one loves me. I'll never find a spouse. Maybe you looked and said, you know what, I'm not successful at what I do. I'm just not good at it. I'm just not good enough. You know what, I shouldn't go to church. I don't deserve to go to church. I don't deserve to be around those people because they're better than me. Satan is feeding you those lies. See, every time that you hear a lie or experience a lie, you're experiencing the enemy. And the place we want to start talking about this is in Genesis chapter 3. If you have your Bible, you can open it. It's the first book, ching, ching, Genesis. We're going to flip to the third chapter in the book of Genesis. I'll update you. God has created the universe. He created it in 6 days, and on the seventh, he rested. I hope and pray that you rest on the seventh day. I don't. I rest on the sixth. It's hard on Sunday. But he had created the earth, and he created man, realized that man was in trouble. He couldn't decorate the garden, so he created woman. Man and woman were created. God said everything was good. And then, after everything was good, somebody comes onto the scene. I want you to watch. This is Genesis chapter 3, verse 1. Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. He said to the woman. Now it talks about a serpent, doesn't it? So how do we know that it's Satan? Well, we wouldn't know that unless we went to the book of Revelation, in the book of Isaiah, in the book of Job, where Satan is called directly the serpent. Right now, we just know that there's a snake who's talking. That should give us a pretty good idea. At this point, he has legs, so he just walked up to him because we know later on that God will curse the serpent. And the serpent, the snake, will have to crawl on his belly the rest of his life, and women will have to have children and have childbearing pains, and men will have to work and toil the land. But right now, what we're seeing is that Satan, the serpent, is walking up and speaking to Eve. Isn't it interesting how the serpent sneaks up on Eve? You see, there's a lot of similarities between a snake and Satan. I was studying about a snake this week. What do you call a snake person? Is that like a ortho? Nobody can help me. Y'all don't know it either, do you? I study agriculture, and I don't know. Okay. We'll call a snake person. So I was studying snake people this week, and I was reading about a snake, and you know, a snake, it's interesting, it never closes its eyes. A snake can always watch, is always paying attention, never closes its eyes. I also saw that snakes have forked tongues. Makes you think about the lies that Satan does. They eat their prey whole. That relates to Satan. They have a great camouflage. They're very quiet. And then many of them have a venomous bite. See, Satan came in disguise. He managed to sneak up on the woman without her realizing who it was. And then the interesting thing is that the snake began to speak her language. See, Satan speaks your language. He knows your language. Your language might be lust. Your language might be pride. Your language might be anger. And he knows how to speak it. He knows how to speak it at the right moments because you think about it, he's been in existence at the very beginning of time. See, he's been there with God the whole time, so he's been studying the playbook. He knows your plays, and he knows you, and he was there when God created you. And we'll talk about in a minute how he can go to heaven and be around God. So no telling what all he knows about us. Now, Scripture calls Satan all sorts of different names. So you may be like, well, I don't believe in Satan. I don't think this is real. It's just nonsense. Well, listen. Here's some of the names that the Bible calls Satan from Genesis to Revelation. He's the Antichrist. He's the murderer. He's the liar. He's the destroyer. He's the god of this world, the tester, the enticer, the stealer, the thief, the great and fiery dragon, the prince of power of the air, the power of darkness, Beelzebub, ruler of the demons is what that means. 1 Peter 5:8 says he's an adversary. It says your enemy, the devil, roars around, like prowls around, like a roaring lion, seeking to devour and destroy you. But here's the interesting thing. So where did he come from? I mean, you know, I'm just thinking about it. All of us believe in angels, and we believe in Jesus, and we believe that God came in the form of a man, which is really weird. You know, Christianity is a really weird story if you've never heard it. God came in the form of a human, and he lived amongst the people, and the people persecuted him, and what did he do? He went to the cross and let them kill him, and then he was resurrected. We're so used to that. So we're used to all that, and we talk about all that, but why don't we talk about the demons and Satan? Why didn't you hear this when you were growing up? Why didn't you hear sermons on it? How many of you have ever heard a sermon on Satan in the Protestant church? Oh, that explains it. Look around. How many of you have ever heard a sermon on Satan? I cannot talk. It's unreal, isn't it? But Satan is all the way through the Scriptures. But the problem is, our society has turned Satan into something that he's not. You see, most of us picture, what do you picture? I want you to picture Satan right quick. Is that what you're picturing? That's what you're picturing, isn't it? A lot of you. I want to show you a picture. Let's get the snake. Let's get the snake. I'm over the snake. Let's go to the, well, there's the snake. That was Satan. Okay, so there's the snake. I missed that one earlier. Let's go to the picture of Satan, though. I mean, that's kind of it, isn't it? It's kind of what most of us picture, this guy with a red fork and a pitchfork. And from what I was studying, that came from the medieval times. And people wanted to develop a relatable Satan. And so they came up with this image with a pitchfork where he could, like, keep people away from Jesus. Which is cool and all, but that's not what the Bible teaches. If you have your Bible, I want you to turn to the book of Ezekiel. Have fun finding that one. Choose the front. It's got a comment. It's got like a list of them, and they're in order. We're going to turn to Ezekiel chapter 28, verses 13 through 15. And we're going to see what the Bible says. It's actually, if you read your commentator, he's talking about the king of Tyre. But they also say that this is a perfect description of Satan and referring to Satan at the same time as the king of Tyre. So it says, "You are the seal of perfection, full of wisdom and perfect in beauty." You're in the garden, or you're in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone adorns you, carnelian, crystallite, and emerald, topaz, onyx, and jasper. Lapuz, lazuli. I want to name our next child that. I hope we don't have one. Turquoise and beryl. Your settings and mountings were made of gold, and on the day you were created, they were prepared. So let's focus on the highlighted point, full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. Satan is very, very wise. He's very cunning. He's very crafty, as Genesis 3:1 says. He obviously thought that he could outwit God, so he's not an idiot. If he thought that he could outwit God, he wouldn't be very bright. Of course, he's not very bright that he thinks he can outwit God, but you know what I'm saying. He's been with God throughout all history, as I mentioned, so he's full of wisdom. He's perfect in beauty is what the Bible tells us. If you want to write down 2 Corinthians 11:14, the Bible tells us that Satan masquerades as what? Anybody know? Anybody know? It's a good Sunday school lesson. What should we study in Sunday school? I don't know. Probably the things I mentioned you don't know that are obvious. I'm just kidding. I'm kidding. Study. 2 Corinthians 11:14. Satan masquerades as an angel of light. It's what the Bible says, what Paul says, if you trust Paul. You see, Satan is beautiful. Just take lust, for instance. I was talking to a guy this week that was really battling with lust. Somewhat of an accountability partner for me. Computer screen he has to stay away from. Why? Because it draws him in. Why would a computer screen draw somebody in? It's because there's something beautiful there. It's a human body, right, that God created. God created that person as someone's daughter, it's someone's wife, and she's on a screen and she's beautiful. And she's supposed to be enticing, but she's not supposed to be enticing in the way that he's looking at it. You see, Satan masquerades as an angel of light. Now, if we read on Ezekiel 28, 14 through 15, "You are anointed as a guardian cherub. For so I ordained you. You were on the holy mount of God. You walked among the fiery stones. You were blameless in your ways from the day you were created until wickedness was found in you." Okay, I read that pretty quick, but what it basically says is that Satan is an angel. He was a guardian angel, a guardian cherub. Now, I know some of you, when you think of cherub, you think of the fat baby on the diaper thing, right? But I wanted to put some pictures up here, but none of them were graphic enough. When I got my calling into ministry, I saw an angel in a dream, and I'm going to share that with you guys in our next sermon series called Testify. It's going to be really, really fun, and people are going to share their testimonies. Anyway, yeah, advertisement. So, but I saw this angel, and it was so beautiful and so powerful and just so, I just couldn't come up with the words to describe it in the dream. And I want you to picture Satan like that, that he's so beautiful and just big. I don't know how to put it into words. But he was a guardian cherub. We don't know what he guarded, but most scholars will tell you that Satan was one of the highest ranking angels, probably the most high ranking angel. When were the angels created, by the way? Anybody know? I thought this was interesting. I was studying it this week. You know, the book of Job actually tells us that the angels were there before the creation of the earth because it says that they came and they had been roaming. And God mentions that they were there with him when he was creating the foundations of the earth. And he says basically to Job, he says, well, how dare you, or to Satan, I believe he says to Satan, I can't remember, I'm getting confused. But The point of the scripture is, if you read it in Job, let me give it to you. Be gone, Satan. Job 38, 4 through 7. I want you to write that down. Job 38, 4 through 7. It says, when God was laying the earth's foundation, the angels were rejoicing. So they were here before humans were. And of course, Satan was in the garden before Adam and Eve were. Isn't that interesting? He was already there. So sometime God created Satan. Remember that God created him. So he's just like us. He rebels. But the problem is, he doesn't repent and go to the cross like we do. So let's look at Satan's fall, Ezekiel 28:16. Through your widespread trade, you were filled with violence and you sinned. So I drove you in disgrace from the mount of God, and I expelled you, guardian cherub. I expelled you, guardian cherub, from among the fiery stones. If you read Revelation, how many of you read Revelation just in your spare time? Revelation people, love Revelation. Everybody preached on Revelation, right? I've never preached on it. I've got to do that, but I haven't done it yet. I keep panicking. But Revelation chapter 12 tells us that Satan was thrown out of heaven. And interestingly, it says that one third of his angels were taken with him, that the tail of the dragon swept one third of the angels. I don't have it on the screen for you. But he was expelled and kicked out. Jesus says, if you don't believe Revelation and John's crazy visions, Jesus says in Luke chapter 10, verse 18, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. And that's Jesus. Well, that's a metaphor. No. Just read for yourself. We know in the book of Job, chapters 1 through 2, that Satan can still go to heaven and talk with God. I find this very interesting. That one day the angels came to present themselves to the Lord, and Satan came with them. And the Lord said to Satan, where do you come from? And he said, from roaming throughout the earth and going back and forth. So Satan goes to God, Satan comes to earth, Satan goes to God. Satan's not kicked out of heaven, Satan's just kicked out of the governance of heaven. So he can't rule in heaven. He can still go up there until he's expelled. Now Satan's fall, watch this. This is the book of Isaiah, Isaiah 14, verses 13 through 15. I wish I could sing some of this. It'd be really entertaining. Sometimes I need to change my voice, but listen to this. How have you fallen from heaven? It sounds like a song. It really does. How have you fallen from heaven, morning star, son of the dawn? You've been cast down to the earth, you who once laid low the nations. You said in your heart, I will ascend to the heavens. I will raise my throne above the stars of God. Listen for his pride. I will sit enthroned on the mount of assembly, on the utmost heights of Mount Zaphon. I will ascend above the tops of the clouds. I will make myself like the Most High. But you were brought down to the rim of the dead, to the depths of the pit. It's Isaiah 14, verses 13 through 15. So Satan has pride. That's why he got kicked out of heaven. He thought that he was more powerful than God, and he thought that he was more beautiful than God. We go back to the book of Ezekiel, chapter 28, verse 17. It tells us, it says, your heart became proud on account of your beauty, and you corrupted your wisdom because of your splendor. You know, pride will get you in trouble. Anybody here have a problem with pride? Pride keeps you from coming to the cross. Pride keeps you from hitting your knees. Pride keeps you from letting go and keeps you from saying, I'm sorry. Pride will break your marriage apart. It'll keep you from having a good relationship with your kids. It'll definitely keep you from having a relationship with God. Satan's problem is that he had pride. He wanted to be more beautiful than God. He couldn't let it go. He couldn't repent and say, I'm sorry, I trust you and I believe in you. Even though you created me, I'm going to submit to you. He couldn't do that. And so pride is the issue, unrepentance. Let me tell you about Satan's playground. That's what it says, Ezekiel 28, verses 16 through 17. It says, so I threw you to the, where? To the earth. I made a spectacle of you before kings. The world is Satan's playground. In fact, you're his playground. So I don't think we realize this. That we're Satan's sliding board. We're Satan's swing. He's having fun with us. You know why? Because he knows that he can't after Jesus comes back. See, when Jesus comes back, you're not going to have to deal with it. You know, when Jesus comes back, if you're a believer, you're going to get to stand in heaven before God. Do you understand that? You see, that's why our church isn't growing right now, because we're not saying amen, brother. Now, I'm being serious. You don't have to say amen. You don't have to fake it. See, when you start saying amen, when you realize that people, when they die, either go to heaven or hell and either stand before, they all stand before our God, but either spend eternity with our God or without our God. Then we get serious about making disciples in this church. Then we get serious about praying for each other. See, the truth is, I think a lot of us Protestants don't really believe that all this stuff is real, because it's a whole lot easier for us just to say, you know what? Let's just leave that up to the fundamentalists, and we'll make fun of them. We'll make fun of all the people at Halloween put on the shows with, you know, what was it I went to as a youth group? Like, you're going to hell, and had Satan like pop out of a can, and it was terrible. And we would leave, and we'd be like, those people were crazy, but that sure was fun. But just what if all of this is true? What if? What if the demons are just as true as the angels? What if Satan is just as true as God? Just what if? You see, I believe with all my heart that it is, but I can't convince everybody of that. The Holy Spirit has to share that with you. And so I ask you to open God's Word and you to read from the book of Genesis to the book of Revelation, and you see what Jesus says about Lazarus. You see how many times Jesus cast demons out of people? Well, those were just epileptic episodes. You ever heard that? Okay? You know, like somebody's, like the story of the kid convulsing, and you're like, oh, he's just having a seizure. Really? And then what about the 2,000 pigs? Remember, my name is Legion. Do you remember? I mean, that's a true story. My name is Legion. And Jesus goes over and he cast out the demons, and how many demons come out? They fill 2,000 pigs. And they run into a lake. Now, is that story in there just to be funny? Or is there really a presence of the enemy? And is that really the problem in your marriage and the problem in your job and the problem in your life and your self-confidence? I think there's a spiritual battle going on that we have been unaware of in this church and in this community and in our lives. And that's what this series is about. Opening your eyes to it. You don't have to believe it, but I challenge you to. See, I want to give you three verses today, and then we're going to do something really cool. Ephesians chapter 6. Everybody needs to know this one. If you don't know this one, there's a whole series we've got to preach on how to put on the armor of God. Some of you are studying Priscilla Shire right now. Awesome book about the armor of God. Our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the what? Spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Some of us got stuck on flesh and blood. Some of us think our struggle is against flesh and blood. Well, my husband, I need to do a woman's voice, sorry. My husband's the jerk. It's all my husband's fault. My kids are hellions. Now I'm going to tell you what you need to do. You need to pray over your house. You need to get some people in the church and pray over your house. You see, that happened in our house this week. It's pretty cool. I had a group of women there. I walk in, and they're just like, they all have their eyes closed. They're just talking. I'm like, I just need to get my keys. I'm out of here. And they're praying over our home. You want them to pray over yours? You just ask me. We'll get a group out there. You see, you need to pray over your marriage. You don't understand. You think of having these problems with your spouse. Why don't you pray together? Just come to my, I'd love to pray with you. We just don't get it that there's this struggle going on, and Paul says it, and John says it, and Peter says it, and Jesus says it, and Moses writes it, and it's just crazy. So 1 Peter 5:8, this is another good one for you, says, be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Now, I cannot figure out how to make that a metaphor. That just seems real to me. Paul's saying the devil prowls around. He's looking for someone to devour. It says, be alert. That means be awakened, church. Be alert. And it says, be sober. I didn't hear anything on that one. Be sober all the time. Be sober, okay? Be sober. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, okay? So the last verse I want to give you is, what do we do about it? And this is what we're going to do today. 1 John chapter 4, verse 4. Love this verse. Love it, love it, love it. You, dear children, are from God and have overcome them because the one who is in you is greater than the one who is in the world. The one who is in you is greater than the one who is in the world. The one who is in you is greater than the one who is in the world. I want this side of the congregation to say, the one who is in you. Okay, y'all, a little weak. Let's say it again. The one who is in you. And now I'm going to come over here, starting to turn to a cult. Is greater than the one who is in the world. Let's try that one more time. You see, you need to remind each other of that. That the one who is in you is greater than the one who is in the world. You have nothing to fear of Satan if you know Jesus Christ. But I want to tell you this, you can't battle Satan alone. And don't think you can. I heard somebody, they were like, I became a believer. And I was like, bring it on, Satan. I'm like, don't do that. Don't do that. Because Satan will bring it on. I mean, it all hell will break loose. And so here's the thing for the day. I want us to pray over each other today. And it was really cool this morning. So 8:45 is very different than 11. Like 8:45 are like, I don't know, they're just up for more stuff. It's really weird because they're up early and I don't know if it's the coffee. And then you guys kind of like, y'all just like don't want to like touch each other. I don't know what it is. Like you come and like it's good and you listen, you pay attention, but you don't like want to commune and stuff. So I don't know. We got to work on this. So what we're going to do is I want to pray for you in here, and I want people to pray for you. And I didn't plan well, so I don't know who's going to pray for you. But I believe there's some people in here who can rise up and pray for you. And I'm going to be in the back, and I don't think I freaked people out this morning, but I put the sign of the cross on their head, and I just reminded them that they belong to Jesus Christ. That's what we're going to do this morning. So if you're willing to pray for people when we get up, I just want you to go to the back, and if you would just come back there and be prayed for, we're going to pray over you and your marriage and your house. We're going to pray protection over you. Say, what does that look like? It's pretty simple. Jesus, protect these people. We love you. So Emily's going to come up and lead our last two songs. And during that time, we're going to be in the back and we're going to pray for each other. It's really, really powerful if you would just allow God to work. Don't be the person that goes, are they going to get up? Are they going to get up? Don't do that. Just get up and go and be prayed for. It's nothing awkward. You know, the Bible tells us to do this. And so the goal for this service is that we're going to start praying for each other regularly. Now, if you're a visitor this morning, I just want to tell you it's okay to sit in your seat. Don't feel awkward. But about 99% of the people in here know Jesus Christ, and we got to start equipping people. People have got to get equipped. Everybody knows Jesus. 99% of us in here know Jesus Christ. So why do we keep saying, if you don't know Jesus, come to? That's great. But we got to learn how to pray for each other. So we're going to be in the back. Music's going to be playing. Sign of the cross on your head. And we're going to protect ourselves from the enemy. Father God, I thank you for the people that came today. I thank you for the message that you've helped me deliver amongst stuttering words. I thank you for the message that you have given, the message, Father, that you have inspired. I pray today that people can hear it. I pray that we're courageous enough to read your scriptures and to know that you talked about the devil and demons and Satan all the time and dealt with it. I want to pray for freedom over all the people today and hear from evil. I want to pray protection over them, God. I pray that your Holy Spirit can anoint them. I pray that if anybody came in today and they're just really struggling, they're down, they're depressed, they don't feel like they have confidence, etc., that today in the name of Jesus, they leave this place feeling changed. I pray they leave changed, not because they heard a good song or they heard some phrase in the sermon that worked, but I pray they feel changed because they experience you, that they meet you. So, Father, as our congregation gets up today, because I believe that they will, I ask that you anoint the people who are praying with the gift of prayer. You give them the words to say over people, that our prayers may be short, but that they're powerful, and that this congregation experiences the love, the forgiveness, the power, and the protection of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we all pray.